Okay, so good morning to all of you. It is nice to be in this session on faculty development program on research in energy, and I am sure that there will be various subjects on energy. I am going to touch about electric vehicle technology, trends, what type of research we can do in this area, and what are we doing in the area of skill development. So ARI has been given a task by the Ministry of Industry, Department of Heavy Industry and Public Enterprise, where we have also received support from AICTE and Automotive Skill Development Council for this electric vehicle awareness program. So under this, I have a privilege today to give a presentation in this area. So all of you know that electric vehicles are having less parts compared to an IC engine vehicle. And if it really has less parts compared to IC engine vehicle, it is supposed to be cheaper. Even though today it is not cheap because the production quantity is less. Most of the time, the cost of a product is dependent on the scale of production. Today, since electric vehicle sale of production is very less, for example, last year, India sold only 3,600 electric vehicle cars. Yes, India sold 6 lakhs electric three-wheelers and around 1 lakh electric two-wheeler. So in India, typically two-wheelers and three-wheelers sell more and electric passenger vehicles are selling less. But a time would come that this will also improve. So we always say that electric vehicle gives less emission or zero emission. But there is a group which says somewhere else the electricity is produced and there is emission there. So what is important is we need to consider when we compare an electric vehicle with an IC engine vehicle, we need to compare from well to tank and tank to wheel, indirectly from well to wheel. So whether it is fuel like petrol and diesel, which are refined in a refinery and then transported through the tankers and reaches the petrol pump, and then we fill the fuel at the petrol pump and run the engine, or wherever the electricity is generated, and then that electricity is transmitted to our home or at the charging station and we charge our electric vehicle. So when we talk about well to wheel, the electricity transmission from the from where it is produced till our house or at the charging station is not very efficient. There are a lot of losses, whereas once the electricity reaches the car and the car's batteries are charged, then the conversion into mobility is very efficient. It can be as high as 80% efficient. Contrary to that, the fuel, when it is produced, it creates a lot of emission, but the transport of fuel from the refinery to the petrol pump is efficient, but the engine itself is not efficient. A thermal efficiency of the engine can be as high as 40% or maximum 50% is what everyone targets to. But today I would say the average efficiency is around 30%. It also depends on how you drive the vehicle and how you use clutch, brakes and other things. What you get at the wheel may be much lower. It may be just 20%. So when we compare well to wheel, both are equal and it depends on number, how you play with it, and you can show electric vehicle is more efficient or IC engine vehicle is more emission. But when we talk in terms of emission, let's take an example in terms of CO2 and NOx and particulate matter. A gasoline vehicle will emit very high CO2 emission, which leads to global warming. Compared to that, an electric vehicle, even if you consider generation of electricity at the power plant, it is one third of that of a gasoline vehicle in terms of CO2 and also half in terms of NOx. But when you use renewable like solar energy and wind energy, then there is zero emission, no NOx, no PM and so on. So it is advisable that if we start using renewables like solar energy, wind energy, hydropower, then no one will blame that somewhere else the electricity is generated, it creates emission. So we all need to move towards that direction. Let's have a sneak peek into the history. Somewhere in 1800 onwards, lot of research work was done on electric vehicle. And in 1889, between Paris and New York, there used to be taxis which were electric vehicle. Later on, Detroit Electric started producing electric vehicles, but also Henry Ford started manufacturing IC engine cars on a very mass scale. So the first mass produced model was T Ford of Henry Ford. And this is something which deals a blow to the electric vehicle. And slowly, steadily, the electric vehicle disappeared from the market and IC engine fueled vehicle became more prominent till the oil crisis came and the prices of the oil went very high. The petrol and diesel became very costly, and also it gave a fear that after 50 years, petrol and diesel may not be available. We may use all the reserves, or after 100 years, it may not be available. This fear and this cost of fuel again mooted the research on electric vehicle. Moreover, in 1990, California Air Resources Board introduced the Clean Air Act, where they talked about zero emission mandate, that at least some vehicle must emit zero emission. And that is how people again started working on electric vehicle. And then you had very good models. You all know that India also was selling electric vehicle through Reva Electric. And then we had in Europe, Kevet and later Buddy from 1991. So commercially, I would say after Detroit Electric in 1991, electric vehicle resurfaced in Europe. Then Japanese Toyota and Honda took it forward and they made the best vehicle, Toyota Prius and Honda Insight. Then came Reva Electric in 2001 and disappeared, and now Mahindra has taken over as Mahindra Electric, and they have again started producing electric vehicle in India, and so does Tata Motor, Hyundai and other companies. I am sure by the end of 2020, lot of companies would come up with their electric vehicle model. Tesla came in 2004 and they launched their first vehicle in 2008. Then came Nissan Leaf in 2010. And now there are many electric and hybrid vehicles which are sold in the market in India and abroad. So if you look at the prevailing conditions related to automotive in terms of society, environment, politics and economics, yes, more and more people are shifting to cities. And a time would come that 50% of the human population in India may be staying in cities. And this will increase traffic. This will lead to a very wrong way of urbanization. It will increase the human population in the cities, which will increase the vehicle population. Also, economically, people are able to buy more cars. So in the cities, you'll find a family can have two cars, two-wheelers and so on. And this is all going to impact the environment in the city. So there could be high pollution, there could be increase of CO2 emission, there would be global warming, climate change, and you would see that it would rain anytime. And whenever the temperatures would increase, the levels of water in the ocean will increase, and this will lead to submerging of many cities near the ocean. In terms of policy, that's why we have emission norms. Since India is following European norms, we have implemented from 1st April 2020 BS6 norm for all type of vehicle. And also we have self-imposed CO2 emissions. Our CO2 emission limits need to be slowly picked up and made lower and lower to compare with that of the Europe. So with this policies and these issues, we move forward. Mobility has become an essential part of our society, and we need to address all these issues which arises from the mobility, whether it is emission, whether higher cost of fuel, or whether it is traffic, or whether it is safety concern. Everything we need to address. Let's look at electric vehicle trend worldwide. There are many countries who have taken a decision to slowly ramp up the sale of electric vehicle and reduce the production of IC engine vehicle. I know it is going to be very difficult to stop the production of an IC engine because there are many such applications like gensets and heavy commercial vehicle buses and off-highway application vehicles, which will still use engine as a prime mover. So let us look at some of the European countries like Finland, Netherlands, these are the countries who are very, very proactive in use of electric vehicle. For example, Finland is the fastest growing electric vehicle market, followed by South Korea, and then Australia, and then Netherlands. Norway is another country which has more than almost 50% share of electric vehicle being sold in their market. So the top three electric vehicle manufacturers are USA, China, and Norway. You would see that Norway is a very small country, but 56% of the vehicle sale is electric vehicle, more than 50%. In the year 2019, this year it is supposed to touch 60%. With Norway taking the lead, there are many countries who are promoting use of electric vehicle, including India. So as I told you, India sold 3,600 electric car last year against total 3.6 million. So which is just 0.1% of the total population of the vehicle sold. India is selling 0.1% of electric vehicle. And hence, you don't find India anywhere in this number of cities, number of countries. But India is making an attempt. It is expected that by the year to 2030, there would be at least 8% of electric vehicle penetration in India. And as I told you, last year we produced 1,26,000 two-wheeler, 6.3 lakhs three-wheelers, and just 3,600 electric passenger vehicles. But in the subsequent year, this is going to increase. And this can increase by 5%, 10%, 20%, 30%. There are various predictions. So can we take a poll? I am not sure whether we can take a poll. But if we can take a poll, you can prepare that. I want the audience to tell whether we will be able to sell 5%, 10%, 20%, or 30% of penetration by 2030. We have 10 years to go, and we have to move from 0.1% to at least 10% or 30%. So Niti Aayog, the think tank of India, believes that it would be around 8%. It believes that it would be around 30%. SIAM, Society of Indian Vehicle Manufacturers, feels that it would be 40%. And there are some predictions like Goldman Sachs, which says it would be just 8%. So we are much behind China and Europe. But India can catch up with USA, Europe, and also maybe China in terms of electric vehicle. So if you look at the goals, if you look at the government support, the National Electric Mobility Mission Plan 2020 was launched, and the FAME scheme was launched to support electric vehicle. FAME stands for Faster Adoption and Manufacturing of Hybrid and Electric Vehicle in India, which was mooted by Niti Aayog, and it is run by Department of Heavy Industry and Public Enterprise, Government of India. So we have a vision to sell 6 million electric vehicles, and through FAME, a lot of subsidies have been given, a reduction in GST rate has been given, and also we have started producing electric vehicle on a large scale since EESLL, Energy Efficiency Service Limited, ordered or floated tenders for 10,000 electric vehicle, and Tata and Mahindra came forward to supply them. We have also standards on testing and certification of electric vehicle, and also the first generation public EV charger. So all these are ready. And then there are many companies like Ola, Uber, Glide, Ather, BlueSmart, Electric Field, Zibi, Revel, E-Bike Go, Gen Z, Cowboy, Aviv, and Bird, who has started working in the field of electric vehicle and also started selling their ideas. So FAME, which was introduced, first FAME 1 was introduced and later FAME 2 was introduced. Initially, FAME 1 was more directly proportional to the cost of the vehicle, or the percentage was around 15% subsidy. the customer have to pay 15% less, and the company who produce electric vehicle will directly get that subsidy. Customer pays directly 15% less. But FAME II was, all those loopholes were closed, and FAME II is much more practical scheme, which has four focus: technology development, demand creation, pilot projects, and charging infrastructure. Yes, most of the people ask that I can buy electric vehicle, but two reasons which stops me for buying. Number one, it is costly. And number two, I am not sure how would I charge it. So we are trying to bridge this gap by having more and more charging stations. And if this happens in a mass scale range, then the cost of the vehicle will also come down. So the think tank of India, Niti Aayog, has generated a report on India Leaps Ahead. You can just Google India Leaps Ahead and you will get this report, which says that India can save 60% of anticipated road-based mobility-related energy demand and 37% of carbon emissions by 2030 by pursuing a shared electric and connected mobility, resulting in net saving of roughly 4 lakh crores of rupees by 2030. This is what is the prediction of our Niti Aayog. And as I told you, FAME I and then FAME II. FAME II was implemented from 1st April 2019, and it has another two more years to go. And it has three broad verticals. One is incentive, second is charging infrastructure, and third is knowledge dissemination. So in terms of demand incentives, the maximum outlay is there. And in terms of charging infrastructure, around 400 crores of rupees have been kept. In terms of administrative expenditure, including publicity and other activities, 13 crores have been kept. And that's how 5,000 crores of rupees has been kept aside for penetration of electric vehicle through scheme FAME. So here you can see that in earlier it was 15% of the cost. Now it depends on what size of battery you are using, what size of motor you are using. Based on that, the subsidy is given. The subsidy can be as low as 20,000 rupees or it can be as high as 50 lakhs rupees. So a lot of general awareness has happened about electric vehicle. A lot of startups have started working on electric vehicle. There are more startups on two-wheeler than three-wheeler and four-wheeler. For example, Ather Energy, Torque Motor, Revolt IntelliCorp, Influx Motor, and Ultraviolet Automotive. These are some of the companies who have started producing electric two-wheelers or electric motorcycles. And the prices are ranging from 1 lakh rupees to 3 lakh rupees. And there are some who are coming out with a new idea of not selling the vehicle with the battery. The battery is given on rent or on lease, where the vehicle is purchased by the customer. So these are some of the startups who have started working in the area of electric vehicle. And these are some of the requirements in the policy making. As I told you, SIAM predicts 40% penetration by 2030. Niti Aayog predicts 30%. And there are some who predicts even 5%, 10%, and so on. So India reaches EV sales shares across all modes of 29% in 2030. And by 2030 in India, 72% of two-wheeler, 31% of car, and 24% of buses would be electric. So you can foresee that electric vehicles would be more in two-wheelers. Yes, there are challenges which we need to meet, and we'll work on those challenges. So now let's quickly see how electric vehicles are categorized or defined. So we have off-road vehicle within the campus where no certification is required. Certification required only if the vehicle is running on Indian road. If the wattage is less than 250 watts, then one does not even have to take a certification. But they need to inform ARI saying that this is less than 250 watt and the speed is less than 25 km per hour, then they may get a permission. Similarly, we have e-rickshaws. E-rickshaws up till now were using lead-acid battery, and now they have shifted to lithium-ion batteries. Then we have passenger vehicles like from Tata and Mahindra, who are making electric vehicles. Electric two-wheeler is something which is becoming more and more predominant. And e-auto also has been approved from this year. and heavy vehicles M2 and M3 category. Yes, so there are expectations from electric vehicle that it must meet AIS standards 39, 40, 41, and it must give a very good efficiency and drivability. So we have different types of electric vehicle, the one which is pure electric vehicle, or it is a hybrid vehicle where engine and battery both are there, or it is a plug-in hybrid electric vehicle system, or it is an hybrid electric vehicle. So we have all the options, and then we have also hydrogen fuel cells and fuel cell electric vehicle and so on. So if you see a configuration of an electric vehicle, you have, just give me a minute. Am I audible? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Fine. Yes, sir, so I'll continue. I have finished 25% of my presentation. I'll move faster now. Is the speed okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Fine. Yes, sir. Okay. We can have question answer session at the end. So I look forward to a lot of questions. So let's look at a typical electric vehicle which has no engine, and we have a battery. Most of the time we are now using lithium ion battery, but there are different types of battery material which we'll discuss. And then from battery, we convert DC into AC, give it to the electric motor, and then through the transmission, it gives the drive to the vehicle. And then we also have a controller and a battery management system. Okay. So then finally, we have an electric vehicle which has battery pack, motor, inverter, and battery management system. So battery management system is the heart of the system, which will take care by monitoring the temperature, doing the cell balancing, ensuring that the battery is charged, ensuring that the entire system is balanced and there is no health hazards. So these are the various components of the electric vehicle. I would say there are four major component pillars of electric vehicle. The electric machine, basically the motor, the energy management system or a battery management system, the power electronics and the control required for running the electric vehicle, and the energy storage system like battery. So these are the four pillars of electric vehicle. And let us have look at all four of them, and also look that what research is being done and what we all as a researcher and academicians can work in this field, right? So let's look at that one by one. Before that, I would say that whenever we shift to electric vehicle, there is a process by which we gradually shift. So today we are shifted directly to electric vehicle and not hybrid vehicle. One of the reason is electric vehicles would be cheaper than a hybrid vehicle, because in a hybrid vehicle you require an engine and battery and motor, whereas in electric vehicle you don't require an engine, you just require battery and the motor. And hence, as a general observation, we started with electric vehicle. But if you really want to have a very efficient vehicle, then, and also a good performance vehicle, then hybrid vehicle would be the answer. But then today we have a fear that hybrid electric vehicle itna costly hai, toh hybrid vehicle kitna costly hoga. Yes, you are correct, but with economics of scale, with mass production, these prices may go down. So in India, we have to parallelly work on electric vehicle and its more penetration. We also have to work on hybrid vehicle and one day switch over to hybrid vehicle. Also, we need to work on fuel cells and hydrogen as a fuel. That is altogether a new area coming up, but it's coming up very fast. So there is going to be a disruption, and we need to see that whether all these can coexist together. Like today, CNG, LPG, petrol, diesel are coexisting. Similarly, electric vehicle, hybrid vehicle, fuel cell vehicle will also coexist. So we start with micro hybrid, that is basically a engine stop and go, and then go to mild hybrid, medium hybrid, full power electric vehicle, and then plug-in hybrid. So looking at the electric vehicle, first component, that is a motor. We have different types of motors, and we have traction motor, auxiliary motor, and other motors. And this plays a very, very important role. Motor is like an engine for a vehicle. So this is how a typical electric motor looks like.
Medium hybrid, full power electric vehicle, plug-in.
Hello?
So looking at the electric vehicle, first component that is a motor. We have different types of motors, and we have traction motor, auxiliary motor, and other motors. And this plays a very, very important role. Motor is like.
I think by mistake the recording is started. Fine, I would continue. This is a typical motor which has a stator, rotor. We use magnet here, and the magnet is a big bottleneck from supply chain. Most of the magnets are coming from China, and now we have taken a decision that we will manufacture. So Pune is the hub where magnets are manufactured, and very soon the electric vehicle, which has got a halt because of parts not coming from China, will start. India would start producing all these components, and then it would become a viable solution. So this is how a motor looks like. There are different types of motor: permanent magnet motor, induction motors, switch reluctant, SRM motor, and there are various vehicle manufacturers who use different types of motor. Most of them use induction motor and permanent magnet motor, and then one has to decide which one to use. So there is always an option of which one to use. So when you look at the electric motor performance, the electric motors are very efficient. As I told you, it is more than 80%. Electric vehicles are more than 80% when we talk about from tank to wheel, and it can be varying from 80 to 95%, but 80% is sure. And when we ramp up, as you increase the speed, your power is going to ramp up and then become constant. And the efficiencies are also very high in a motor. So let's look at what type of motor we must use and what are the selection criteria. So we need to decide everything based on the payload, the cost, performance, durability, and then we need to design what type of motor you want, whether you buy it, you make it, what type of controller you want. So companies like Mahindra has now taken decision to build motors, batteries, controllers, battery management system in a big way, and it will become self-sustaining. So let's look at what type of requirements are there from a motor. Basically, cost, performance, and durability. These are the three aspects of a motor. And if you want to reduce cost, then what we need to do, like we can work on low-cost alternate material. If you want to improve the performance, then we need to have a good drivability, better torque and speed. And if you want high life, then we need to work on the demagnetization characteristics. So together they can give a very good design for us to meet all those challenges. For example, position of magnet, number of poles per magnet, solid versus stranded or concentrated versus distributed windings, rotor magnet placement, and so on. So that's how an electric motor is designed. We have all the software available to design motor, and there are certain challenges which we need to meet, and then we need to have the value of the design which we do. So in a motor, we need to work on analytical design, finite element analysis to see that the parts are okay, thermal and structural indicator to see that the temperature are evenly distributed and at one place the temperatures are not very high, and system analysis as a whole to integrate the whole thing and work on the control optimization, full drivetrain analysis, EMI, EMC, and so on. So there are electric motor roadmap, where how do we move forward, what will happen to permanent magnet, what will happen to induction motor, and so on, or whether we are going to use only pure electric vehicle or we will move towards hybrid vehicle. All those things will be discussed. Yes, we must have a separate discussion on electric two-wheeler, because the penetration of electric two-wheeler is as high as 80%. So you can have different options or different configurations of motor in the electric vehicle. and there are pros and cons of that. So we can have a motor in the wheel hub, or we can have motor in the central drive. So today we are having more in the central drive, but eventually it will move to wheel hub, whether it's two-wheeler, three-wheeler or four-wheeler. And then power electronics is another area where cost, safety and reliability needs to work on. And whether we need power supply, or whether we need magnets, or whether we need switch control or various circuits of electric vehicle, power electronics will play a major role. And then in power electronics, whether it is converting from DC to AC or AC to DC is all what you must learn. Then comes power electronics and the control design. And here the challenges are in terms of what component to select, how to adopt them, how to help them, and so on. Then we have battery management system, or this battery management systems controls SOC, SOH, that is state of charge, state of health, and all those things. And it can also safeguard the safety of the device. Okay. Then comes the energy storage devices like batteries. And you can have various cells, and all those cells together combined becomes a module, and then various modules combined together becomes a battery pack. And hence the battery classification can be high power or high energy. And there are battery rating in terms of C, that is 1C, 2C, 3C, and so on. 1C is the charges, when the battery charges discharges in 1 hour, and 2C charges are those where the battery charges and discharges in half an hour. 3C would be something where the battery would charge and discharge in 20 minutes. So basically what we need is a big stack or a pack of batteries where there are secondary cells, primary cells, and we can understand the state of charge and depth of discharge. The battery has to be cooled. So generally, all the electric vehicle manufacturer will put 4 or 5 thermocouples to find out the state of the health of battery. And battery can be cooled by just air convention or a liquid immersion cooling or liquid cooling through channels. So we will discuss more on liquid immersion cooling and liquid cooling, right? So let's look at Dr. Goodenough, the founder of the lithium ion battery. And he found he did a lot of work in this area. And somewhere in 1980, before 40 years, he invented a lithium ion battery in which lithium could migrate through the battery from one electrode to other as a lithium positive ion. He now invents glass battery, which is 3 times better. So with this disruption, the technology is moving so fast that by the time we finish research in one area, the area itself becomes obsolete. So you must start with a broad topic of research and slowly narrow down with the most important consciousness that yes, this technology is going to continue whatever happens. This may not die down. Or it is you who have to make it happen that it retains. So let us wait for the glass factory to come. Till then, we have no option but to get these motors. Okay. Then comes a battery, which are in advanced stage, like lithium ion, nickel metal hydride, metal air, and we need to do more research in this area. And then the form factors of batteries, like cylinder cell, pouch cell, prismatic cells, and so on. So basically, battery cell is a unit with a positive electrode and negative electrode and electrolyte, whereas battery module is a group of physically and electrically connected cells. And then battery pack, which is an array of interconnected modules that has been configured for its intended energy storage application. So these are some of the battery packs for two-wheeler, three-wheeler, for passenger car, and so on. So whether we need high energy or high power. So for example, for certain application, we may require high power, and for certain application, we require high energy. Based on that, we take a decision that what type of batteries we will use. So again, batteries are classified as electrochemistry. Most common are lithium, lead and nickel based battery, but there are a lot of scope and lead acid batteries in the extreme left corner, where the specific power is low compared to the specific energy used to charge the battery. So different countries use different material for the battery. For example, India is using lithium, and the lithiums are maximum coming from Argentina, Bolivia, and Chile in North America. Yes, US imports them, China exports them, and Korea, Japan also exports them. But you would see that battery material plays a very major role. Okay. So we are halfway through, and the last pillar is the charging station. So there are different types of charging stations, and whether they are AC type or DC type, one can closely look at the charging station in the electric vehicle, which are being demonstrated below. So when you talk about charging station, you talk about 5S. It must be safe, it must be scalable, it must help us in saving, it must be secure, and it must be simplified. So these are the 5 standards of electric vehicle and or the 5 themes, and based on that we can take the decision. Okay. So government is having a lot of initiatives on the charging. So this year, FAME will put a lot of money in the charging infrastructure, and the government has come out with various guidelines on what to use, how, what should be the number of charging points, what is the related voltage, and so on. I'm sure it will be a ready reckoner to all my colleagues here. So ARIS also has developed a charging station, for example, a DC charger and an AC charger, and so on. So with this, I talk to you about the trend of electric vehicle in India and abroad. The next, I'll talk about the regulation. Then I'll talk about what are the research areas for us. And then I'll talk about skill development. So there are various standards which are formulated for testing and certification of electric vehicle. You'll be surprised to know that in India, we started working, ARI started working on standards for electric vehicle before 20 years. And at that time, there were nominations from ARI, VRD, Aurangabad, ECMA, and SIAM. So all these members joined hands together and constituted a committee on battery electric vehicle or battery operated vehicles. And then we started developing various AI standards, automotive engine standards. Since BIS takes a lot of time, we decided that we will generate electric vehicle standards and other standards, and we will then normalize it with respect to other countries. So today, ARI is a secretariat for all these standards and tries to normalize. So the mandatory requirement for using electric vehicle in electric cars came in April 2005, somewhere in December 2004. So we have now regulations for two-wheeler, three-wheeler, four-wheeler, whether it's an e-rickshaw or a bus or a truck. So there are standards for electric vehicles, standards for hybrid electric vehicle, and standard for retrofitment. Retrofitment is something new and unique in India. There are two unique things which we are working on in India. One is called retrofitment of the kit on an IC engine vehicle. That means engine needs to be removed and this kit can be planted. So that is about the retrofitment. And then there are also standards for electric vehicle, hybrid electric vehicle, and charging stations. Yes, AI standards, if anyone is interested, we can supply a CD of the AI standards. But basically, AI standard 38, 39, 40, 48, 49 talks more about electric vehicle. And the traction battery is through AIS 048. Chargers, hybrid vehicle, there is a different standard for electric vehicle, different standard for hybrid vehicles, retrofitment, and then so many others, for example, e-rickshaw and others. So these all standards are made by ARI but notified by Ministry of Road Transport and Highway. So as I told you earlier, if the capacity is below 250 watts, then the electric vehicle certification is not required. Yes, you still need a certificate from ARI saying that it doesn't meet this, it doesn't come under the purview. So there are various standards related to EMI, EMC, related to safety, related to noise. And these are very, very important standards which we must adhere to. So ARI has done extensive work in the field of electric vehicle in last 20 years. And it has also a center of excellence on green mobility or the e-mobility. And you name them, all software, hardware, testing and certification, research and development, everything is available here. So now I will talk about research and skill development. We are just 25% of the slides left, and I hope to finish before 12. What type of research can we do in India? Can we make concepts? Can we brainstorm and finalize the concept? Or can we work on modeling, simulation, and optimization? Under this lockdown, since people are not meeting everything, more and more people are working on simulation. So all my students have started working on modeling, simulation, and optimization projects. And then we also need to make a prototype. And we need to work on EV retrofit kit, battery swapping, and so on. So for example, there are starters who are working on battery swapping. That means the vehicle manufacturer, when he sells the car or a two-wheeler or a three-wheeler, he will not sell the battery. For example, Ather Energy, the cost of a smart electric two-wheeler is 1.5 lakhs. If you decide that battery will not be the part of this cost, and then the cost will become only 1 lakh, and many people will be tempted to buy, and he can give the battery on rent, and he can charge 1,000 rupees or 2,000 rupees per month, which otherwise he would have spent money in buying petrol or diesel. So from that point of view, this becomes a very lucrative idea of selling the car without battery and then supplying the battery on lease. And the customer doesn't have to work whether the battery works, doesn't work, charge, discharge, something has gone wrong. Everything is the responsibility of the battery swapper. Similarly, we have a battery management system, BMS, in the second last line. And battery management system has a very, very important role. As I told you earlier, that it discusses the it ensures that the battery is cool. It ensures that battery state of the health is good. The state of charge is also good. And we need to work on a system integration. So all this needs to be integrated together in the form of a roadmap. So when we develop an entire electric vehicle, or we develop the exterior of the electric vehicle with interior having all this all these areas. So we need to work on system validation. We need to work, initially do a QFD, customer awareness. What do the customer want? Quality function deployment is QFD. And then understand what do the customer want and convert the customer's need into the reality. So that is requirements, and based on that, the specifications are decided. And then system functional and architecture design is done. And then substructure designs are being done, including alternate material. So when we move across the V, we need to work on detailed design and optimization, which will help to component integration and verification, and early and reliability verification and system verification. So these are the areas of research. For example, you can work on big data, artificial intelligence, data analytics, or you can work on energy storage solution in terms of lithium-ion batteries and their derivatives, or ultra capacitors, or you can work on software architecture where there is a rapid growth. You can work on charging solutions like wireless charger and vehicle to grid. you can work on electric vehicle, hybrid vehicle, and other vehicles like fuel cell vehicle, or you can work on electric vehicle, how to get more efficient electric motor and high torque motors, or you can work on energy management, where efficient algorithm for battery management systems are discussed. And also you can work on in-vehicle networking, where high need of data exchange is required. So these are some of the current research topic I worked on and noted down for all of you. We have these areas being noted down, and if in case somebody needs any help in terms of literature review or patent review, ARI Academy or AI Knowledge Center will be very eager to help you. So different types of motors, and then we discuss what type of motors we in India should use. But it's nice to know the different types and the energy management system. We need to have a small energy management system here, but here it's not so small. Energy storage system and smart charging solutions. So these are the different ways by which you can charge. We talked about battery swappy solution. So for example, in Ahmedabad, there are 100 electric buses running, and all these buses will come to the station for half an hour. Their batteries would be removed and a charge battery would be installed. So the battery swapping mechanism works very well, even for big vehicles. But what they have done is they need a crane to pick up the battery, bring it out and put the new crane and so on. So we go ahead. Battery swapping is one good business which people must work on. And then we must work on intelligent solution for charging, that how would you charge through renewables. So solar energy, wind energy is something which we are talking about, or a shed, a folding shed above the car, which can help to charge. So we need to work on various storage system, energy, and we need to work on various framework on electric vehicle. So there is a support from grid for electric vehicle. Okay. So as I told you, we need to do a lot of research in data analytics, big data analytics, and artificial intelligence, machine learning. Parallelly, we can do a lot of research in MATLAB. In this lockdown period, the faculty, the professors can work more in simulation work. So I will be showing you all those softwares which are available with us, and in also in intra-vehicle network. So in terms of software architecture for EVs, we need to work on various aspects. And as I told you, simulation would be the most important research area in India. We can use various software for the simulation, and system-driven simulation for e-mobility is what is our mantra. And then we use model-based development process, key challenges in electric vehicle, and so on. So here are the key challenges: range anxiety, how many kilometers my vehicle will run till I charge the battery once again, and how I going to integrate the electric engine into the system, and what about safety and durability, whether everything is safe or not, and so on. In terms of simulation, it can help in terms of design, verification, validation, manufacturing, and operation. And in terms of multi-physics application of e-mobility, electric mobility will play a major role. In terms of attribute optimization, in terms of software control, in terms of vehicle engineering, data intelligence, new vehicle architecture, electric drive, and electric electromagnetic. So these are some of the softwares which we use. For example, these are FVP, RSWR, more from the Ricardo. And then there are others like Gamma Technology, MATLAB, then AVL, these are the people who are going to work on electric vehicle. So we need to work on electric vehicle modeling and simulation. We need to address without by staying at home, we can do a lot of remote work in modeling and simulation. So we need to work on vehicle architecture, battery pack, traction motor and controller. So these are some of the areas where we can work. Also we need to do CFD analysis to find out the thermal analysis. Batteries get heated up, the motor gets heated up. So there must be at least 4 or 5 thermocouples, and then there must be methods to cool them faster. So the new batteries have water jackets around it. That's something which is very inventive. Or they have a fan around it and so on. In terms of noise and vibration, the electric vehicle makes very less noise, but sometimes there may be some whining noise, there may be some rattling noise, and the passenger may not feel comfortable. So it's always advisable to keep the vehicle in a safe custody. And there would be a minimum noise level also required. For example, if you use electric vehicle and the pedestrian is moving on the road, he will not come to know that the electric vehicle is coming behind. He may try to cross the road without looking behind, and this could be very fatal. So we need to have a minimum noise, say for example, minimum 50 dB, the electric vehicle must make the noise, but not more than 74 dB. So it may have a range of 50 to 74. Then we have this establishing the overall system specification response requires an integrated 1D and 3D thermal simulation approach. So a lot of work can be done in this area also, basically linking the solution and exchanging the numbers. So the last slide in terms of research is we need to work on simulation solutions for today, whether it is developing sustainable solution or designing for e-propulsion or and so on. So these are some of the areas in the area of simulation which we must work. Now I come to the last point. So the last 10 slides which talks about skill development. Yes, with new advent of new technology like electric vehicle, hybrid vehicle, fuel cell vehicle, we need to reskill. No one has learned electric vehicle, no one has taught electric vehicle. So first, we as a faculty must learn electric vehicle and reskill ourselves to teach electric vehicle subjects. For example, I am an engine and emission person. My PhD is on emission, but from last 2 years, I have started reskilling myself in the area of electric vehicle. And maybe after 2 years, I would reskill myself in the area of fuel cell vehicle or autonomous cars and other things. So today there is a need to reskill people who are already working in IC engine and automotive sector, or we need to impart new skills to people who have never worked in this area. And to a younger generation, we need to impart these new skills, whether it is battery pack manufacturing, assembly, or whether it is manufacturing or charging infrastructure or servicing of batteries. So reskilling, new skilling, and new skilling other than auto. So we may work in various areas like developing apps for GPS or power electronics or high voltage handling. This will be some of the areas in which we need to learn. And the last is skill replace removed from auto sector. So there are certain areas where the skills have been removed and new skills have been placed. So these key skills needs to be worked on. And one such area, one such program which ARI does with SA India is called eBaha. So before 5 years in 2015, with the Ashirwad of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, we started eBaha. And today, this year, we have 80 applications of teams who want to work on electric Baha. So future is electric, and eBaha is one step towards 100% electric vehicle by 2047. So this is a team who went and met Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, invited him for inauguration. And they said, he said, no, I will not come until you start something very indigenous like use of alternate fuels or use of electric vehicle. And that's how we started working on use of electric vehicle. So the last two slides, a couple of slides where we have been doing a lot of electric vehicle awareness program through Department of Heavy Industry, Ministry of Heavy Industry and Public Enterprise. And we have been going to various colleges before lockdown, but after lockdown, once this started, we stopped going. But we are now started doing online training. Anyone who is interested, any faculty who is interested to bring that in their college, we will be very eager to help you on electric vehicle awareness. We are now working with Automotive Skill Development Council to develop various qualification packs. So we have developed 10 qualification packs, and these qualification packs can be used by professionals, by students, by mechanics and drivers to get trained in this area. So the detailed qualification pack has been done, that what training is required to be given and who will give the training, how the assessment will be done. Everything is ready, and we are ready to launch this in the market. So engineers, students who are working in engineering, students who are studying, can also parallelly do this program. It can be part-time, full-time, so that by the time they get their graduation degree, they also get a certified electric vehicle designer or a test engineer, and then they become more employable. So if anybody is interested, can write to me. So last year, we started a one-year postgraduate diploma in electric mobility, with COEP, with the Cummins College of Engineering for Women and Department of Technology, Savitri Phule, Pune University. So under this scheme, there is 1 year with three trimesters, the first trimester, second trimester, and third. Since today, all these academias are in Pune, ARI, COEP, Cummins, and Department of Technology. Students come to ARI for 2 days and remaining 3 days in their respective colleges, and we teach them state-of-the-art electric vehicle. They also do a lot of practicals and mini projects. The second program which we started, which is approved by AICT, is M.Tech in Automobile Engineering with specialization in powertrain engineering and electric and hybrid vehicle. This course has also started last year, and the new batch has virtually joined ARI, and the lectures have started. And these are the two new programs. We also understand that around 3 lakh students go abroad every year to Europe and USA and Australia for further studies. But this year, none of them are going because the international flights have not started and the visas are not approved. And hence, these 3 lakh students would like to retain themselves in India and do something for a year before going again abroad for in the next year, assuming that COVID-19 will drop down. So this year, in my opinion, in the master course and the postgraduate diploma course after graduation, we will get a cream of students who may be extraordinarily intelligent. And the quality of students coming out from the M.Tech course would be much higher, or for the postgraduate diploma. We also have started a new course on autonomous vehicle. So a postgraduate diploma in electric and autonomous vehicle is something which we have started from this year in association with RIT. And there are more other programs coming up. We have signed up with MIT for a PhD program. So any faculty who wants to do part-time PhD can join this program. We have done a series of training program, almost 25 training program in the field of electric vehicle in this last 3-4 months. For last 6 months, and still those programs are going on. A lot of people are joining those training programs. So in conclude, I would like to say that electric vehicles are here to stay. Electric vehicle will coexist with IC engine, alternate fuel, fuel cell, hydrogen. Everything is going to coexist. India is a country of diversity, and we like diversity of religion, diversity of language, diversity of people. Similarly, there will be diversity of vehicles, but we need to work on component level, sub-component level, materials level, manufacturing levels, assembly, charging, electric vehicle use, end of life, recyclability, reuse, reduce. So there is a lot of scope in working in field of electric vehicle. Still, there is scope of working in the field of IC engine also, but here also. So I leave it on the audience to decide which area is more likely to do research on. But it would be fun to work on electric vehicle research. Yes, you need to learn various software for from Ricardo, Altair, Ensys, AVL. But you also need to learn basics, electronics and electrical engineering. When you go in for EV research, specifically if you are mechanical or automobile engineer. So basically the transformation of skill landscape is taking place. And if you want to penetrate more electric vehicles in India, then we need to transform these skills into various training programs. And this is the place where industry, academia would work together for the development of the students and the development of the country. So that's all from my side. Thank you very much. And if there are any questions, feel free to ask. I'll just take 1 minute. Please frame your question. I'll just drink water and come back.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. We have asked the participants, if you have any questions, you can post it in the chat box and we'll post this question to the presenter. Are there any questions from participants? If you have any questions, you can unmute and ask the questions. Hemant, I think Hemant has raised his hand. Do you have a question, Hemant? Hemant, you can unmute yourself.
Yes, I am back. I am ready and will be very happy to ask questions. If you
yes,
can
sir.
Ask.
Yeah. Yes, sir. We have a guest called Hemant who has raised his hand. Hemant, if you can hear this, can you please unmute yourself and ask the question?
Yeah.
Hemant, are you listening?
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Can you listen to me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Please go ahead and ask your question. Yeah.
Okay. You appeal for the poll on the how much percentage will be the electric vehicles in India at 0.0. Firstly, I congratulate you for the very good and nice presentation. It was a moral boosting presentation for all of us. So I think it is very difficult to predict the percentage. And now there are two, three reasons for that. First is that we do not have that much policy. I think the government has not framed any policy for electric vehicles yet now. Second thing is that it is uncertain. Then we must have charging stations at just like a petrol pumps.
Yes, yes.
We do not have that facility at present. And it will be difficult to predict it also. Say how much charging stations will be there. Throughout drive the vehicle, electric vehicle, and it stops in between, then it is difficult for me unless there is a charging station. And third thing is that if the charging stations are electrically charged, then if it is not renewable, charging stations are not on the renewable energy, saying electric vehicles are pollution free will be totally misleading, sir.
Yes.
So first thing is that we have to develop the infrastructure for charging stations. And then there will be a very nice success for this. Otherwise, what will be happening that people will buy the electric cars. And if they do not have charging stations, then unfortunately, there will be another misleading proportion going into the people that we do not have charging stations and we cannot use electric vehicles. Though they are very efficient and pollution free. So your comments on
this. Yeah, very good. So there are two comments. One is how is government supporting? And second is the anxiety related to charging stations. So let me see if I can put up one slide on the charging, if it is available here. Let me check. Yeah, here it is. I have not shown this in my presentation. It is in some other presentation which I am going to give today afternoon. Can you see the screen? I am talking about EV charging and their standard. So for EV charging standard, what is YIS? That is safety, scalability, saving, security. Radhesa, are you able to see the screen? Radhesa, are you able to see the screen? New screen?
No, sir. No, sir.
No? I think I need to share.
Sir, first, I think you have to.
Yeah, let me
close this window.
Yeah. Stop presenting and then share and then share this. Okay, now can you see the screen now?
Yes sir.
Yes, you can see it.
Yes,
yeah.
Sir. Yes,
so
sir.
First I will answer about the charging thing and then I will talk about government initiative. So whenever we need a charging station, we talk about 5S: safety, scalability, saving, security and simplicity. Lot of work and lot of standards have gone into it. And the second thing is what government is doing in terms of EV charging. So lot of money has been kept aside under FAME 2 as an initiative for charging. So it is not that charging station will be taken up by petrol pump or some private owners. Government is going to fund lot of funding for charging station. So in 2018, Ministry of Power has released guidelines for charging infrastructure to promote safe, reliable, accessible and affordable charging infrastructure. So these are the different types of charging points which they have declared. And based on this, a lot of charging stations are being developed and charging station orders have already been given. If this COVID-19 would have not come by now, 50 cities across India would have got charging station. Today we have charging stations in Bangalore, in Delhi, in Mumbai, in many places. But major 50 cities including Pune and Nagpur, if we need charging stations, they are all ready. And in my opinion, if COVID-19 recedes, then by end of this year, by 2020, there will be 2,000 charging stations across the country. And maybe 20-30 charging station in each cities, and this will slowly increase. Today petrol pump cannot have a charging station because it is risky to sell fuel and charge. Okay.
I request all the participants to keep their mics on mute. Please do not start your mics. Yes, sir, Dr. Vora, sir.
Yeah, okay, fine. Now, yes. What is important is parking lots, malls, theaters, restaurants, hotels, will have charging station more than the petrol pump because it is not advisable to have a charging station at the petrol pump from fire hazard point of view unless there is a big wall. So the petrol pump has to create a big wall and then have a charging station, or there may be altogether different type of charging station at the various locations. So this is going to come up very fast. Government is committed. They have kept 10,000 crores of rupees for this. And this is all very, very important. Otherwise, the pollution level in the cities will not go down. You must have noticed that in this 3 months of COVID-19 lockdown, the atmosphere, the environment has become very green. You can see different colors in the sky in the evening. And the atmosphere has become very green. And animals have started coming on the road. This is all what we need to do to support. And if we use electric vehicles, the overall pollution is drastically go down. And we will have a very clean air to breathe, not only for us, for our future children also. So this is one question about charging station. They are coming. You have to just wait for a year. Second question of what is government doing to facilitate penetration of electric vehicle. Again, through FAME, government is giving a lot of support. Government is talking on CO2 emission norms where we need to reduce CO2 emissions. So there are many automotive industry who will have to produce electric vehicle to have an average CO2 emission lower to get all those benefits. And it today it's only Tata, Mahindra and Hyundai, but by end of this year most of the automotive industry in India will start producing electric vehicle, and two wheeler is going to come up in a very big way. Today there are only 5-6 two wheeler electric vehicle manufacturers, but there are a lot of startups who are working in the field of two wheeler, three wheeler and four wheeler, and you will find a very rapid increase of people who are going to work in the area of electric vehicles. I hope this answers your question. We will have to be very optimistic and support this system.
I hope this has answered your question. Moving on, sir, we have a question on YouTube as well. Our session is live on YouTube as well. Anil Patel on YouTube is asking, traction motors are working well in railways. Why not on road transportation EV?
Okay, well, frankly speaking, I'm not a master in this area, but there are different types of motors which we have done research, and a lot of people are working in the area of motor research. So in case you have more questions related to that, please send an email. My email can be shared, vora.pga@arai.india.com. I will forward it to my colleagues who are doing research in the area of motors, and they can answer this to you. You can also post your questions on ARI website, www.ariindia.com, or there is a special website, mobility.ariindia.com.
We have another question on YouTube, sir. It's from Amirash Jadhav. He's asking, what is the future of current petrol and diesel vehicles in India?
Yeah. So today in ARI, parallelly, there is one more program going on powertrain engineering, the future of engine. We had one Mrs. Parikh from IIT Bombay. She is 80 year old, and she said IC engine is not going to die down so soon. IC engine is going to survive because there are many areas where IC engine would be still required. Say, for example, when we use hydrogen as a fuel, or whether we use fuel cell vehicles, or whether we use hybrid vehicle, engines would be required. Moreover, for off-road application, that means in mining, in construction, also electric vehicles are required. IC engines are required. In shipping, marine engines are also required. So IC engine would continue. In my opinion, everything will coexist. IC engine with petrol and diesel will coexist. Electric vehicle will go. As we discussed in the previous question, penetration of electric vehicle in the next 10 years could be anywhere between 10% to 40%. So remaining 60% still we require fuel like petrol and diesel to run. And so in my opinion, next 100 years, research on IC engine will also continue. Research on electric vehicle will continue. And there will be a convergence where all of them will be used together.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. There are a few more questions here on Microsoft Teams as well, but mostly they are related to a single topic. So I'll just frame the question for all the three together.
Yeah.
It is about disposal of battery systems.
Yes.
How should we dispose of them, and will it affect the environment in any way?
Yes. No, it does affect the environment. Batteries always affect the environment, whether it is lead or whether it is lithium. What is important is that parallelly, we are also working on standards of recyclability, reusability, and reducing. So three R's are very important, and norms are being formalized. For example, today also, if you cannot throw your lead acid battery of a normal car, you have to give it back to the battery supplier from where you're going to get a new battery, and he will give you a very good, a discount, 1,000 rupees or 2,000 rupees, and that is what is purposefully done so that this batteries doesn't go to the landfill, but it goes back in recycling. Similarly, lithium ion batteries are also very costly, very heavy, and there is a new a plants coming up where you can recycle this. So the entire car will be crumpled, different parts, plastics and other components can be removed. from a catalytic converter, like we remove the platinum and rhodium. Similarly, from batteries also the lithium would be removed and can be reused. So all these plants are coming up parallelly, and we are not going to throw away all these things in landfills, right? So all this care we have to take.
Okay, sir. We just don't have time. We will take in one last question, sir.
Yes.
This question is from Amit. He's first congratulated you for the very nice presentation. And his question reads as, my doubt is that increasing EV will increase the demand of electricity and hence the load on power plant. Major part of electricity production in India is shared by thermal power plant running on coal. So yeah. Don't you think that it will result in more carbon emission as coal is the least pure source of energy, which contradicts the purpose of EV?
Yeah, very good question. But I think we need to do a detailed study. Like we have Ministry of Petroleum, Ministry of Heavy Industry and Public Enterprise. Ministry of Heavy Industry and Public Enterprise works on how mobility can be enhanced, how we can use electric vehicle, how production of electric vehicle increases so that the economy builds up and you and me can survive in this economy. Similarly, Ministry of Transport looks after the safety of the vehicles and the roads and the infrastructure. Ministry of Petroleum looks after what type of fuels are required, petrol, diesel, hydrogen, CNG, LPG, and also we have Ministry of Power. So all of them are working in this government, and in this COVID-19 situation, they are making big plans of their vision to make India have a lot of production of energy. And in this program of energy, I must tell you that we are working on solar energy, wind energy, hydel power plant, and so many other areas where through renewables, we are going to generate electricity. And villages would have solar power so that they don't need captive power from this. And in my opinion, by the time the transition takes place of electric vehicle from today, it is 0.1%, tomorrow it will be 1%, and then 10% and 30%. The electricity generation also will be ramped up, and we will be using more of renewables than the thermal power plant. And I'm sure the pollution level will not be so high. It could be also nuclear energy. So if you Google, you will get a lot of information on how India is working towards gaining more electric power generation.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I hope this question has been answered. We are receiving a lot of questions right now. So we'll just ask one more question, sir.
Yeah, so this was the last question. I need to go for the next meeting and the next lecture.
Yes, yeah. Sir. This will be the last question.
Hello.
Professor Praful Kulkarni has asked, as a faculty in engineering, how can we contribute?
Yeah, so first thing is, each and every university and institutes and colleges have to start introducing a subject called electric and hybrid vehicle as an elective. In case you need any help in developing a syllabus, getting material, we have a very good library where we have hundreds of books on electric vehicle. We will support you in that. That is our duty. Once you introduce this subject and if you see the students are getting interested, you can ask your student to participate in events like eBaha, and more events on electric vehicle competitions are coming up. Third is, you need to have all these books in your library. You can buy e-books, you can buy textbooks, and you can buy journals related to electric vehicles. Fourth will be, you must introduce minor and major. So for example, last year we started MTech in electric hybrid vehicle, postgraduate diploma in electric mobility. We are now, even autonomous is another area which we need to work. So we will have to introduce all these subjects. We are there to help you in all these areas and take it forward. And then only we will have students and professors who are doing research in this area. AICT is giving a lot of funding in the field of electric vehicles. So you can get those funding to do your small research. You can use various software to first predict, and then you can work on making prototypes of such electric vehicle in your college and then take it forward. But I am sure an industry will also come forward to give some work to you in the area of electric vehicles if you can gain knowledge and establish competence in those areas. So I think this is all what we ecosystem we need to develop. AICT and ASDC is also going to support this move. So AICT has already agreed that in case somebody wants to do a BTEC course on electric mobility or electric vehicle or an MTEC course on electric vehicle, they would give permission. Today you can start MTEC in automotive engineering, which is already approved by AICT, and you can add any specialization, specialization in electric vehicle, hybrid vehicle, autonomous vehicle, you can do that. I hope that answers to all of you. Right? So I would be very happy to help you out in this area. Thank you very much.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank you on behalf of Department of Mechanical Engineering at Bharati Vidyapeeth for taking out time and addressing this faculty research development program. I wish that you would continue helping us throughout throughout these FDPs and even further FDPs that we may have. Thank you,
sir. Sure. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. Welcome.
Sir, may I interrupt a little bit? Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, I think Dr. Vora sir is leaving for has to leave for a meeting. If you have any questions, you can ask us and in the chat box, we'll just forward it to him.
Yes, sir, told us regarding some certificate course. So I want to details regarding this course.
Oh, yeah, I'll probably will ask.
The more details.
Yes. Yes, sir. What we'll do is we'll ask Vora sir to send us an email. We'll send an email to him and we'll get a reply regarding him. Right now he has to leave for a meeting. So we'll do that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So with this, we'll finish off the session right now. We'll start.
Yeah, the PPT.
Yeah, we'll ask that as well. We'll ask that as well to Vora sir, and if he is willing, we'll share the PPTs with you.
Thank you, sir.
With this,
we'll start at 2:00.
With this, we finish.
The morning session, and we'll start the next session at 2:00. The link will be the same.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.